Welcome along to Tutorial 6. This time around we're going to look at a different way to limit the mobility of your opponent. This next technique, called checkerboarding, is slightly more complicated than we've looked at previously. You're probably familiar with the conventional checkerboarding pattern found on a chess or draughts board, just like this one. Othello, however, isn't played on a chessboard. And just to cause some confusion to start off with, a checkerboarding pattern to an Othello player will look something a little more like this. Checkerboarding is a technique that allows a player to reduce their opponent's mobility, while usually having more pieces on the board than their opponent. However, bear in mind that this won't ultimately warrant adopting a maximisation strategy in the long run. Our aim will be to try to force our opponent to make a loud move, that is a move that takes lots of pieces, or more precisely lots of frontier pieces. So how does it work? Checkerboarding works by creating patterns that force your opponent into a position that sees them with no access to moves through the centre of the bunch. This will be because, firstly, they have a stone at either end of a preferred line, or they have no pieces on major horizontal or vertical lines through the centre, or some combination of the two. Take this simple fictional example. If black was to try to find a move in this position, it would find it impossible. This is because firstly there are no diagonal moves that take a white piece, because each corner piece has an opposite piece that acts as a blocker. There are also no black pieces on the horizontal or vertical lines through the centre. Checkerboarding positions will normally consist of one player's pieces being connected, while the player being checkerboarded will have them scattered across the board. The checkerboarding patterns can then be repeated numerous times through the bunch. We'll see this in a short while. The patterns we're looking for are essentially ones that look like these. Notice that white's pieces are positioned in the corner of the bunch in each case, but we can then join these patterns up to form the building blocks of more complicated checkerboarding patterns. The patterns that checkerboarding creates should be consistent amongst the entire bunch for best effect. Otherwise, opponents will have moves that cut the bunch in other areas, giving them back the access that you're trying to deprive them of. For this reason, it is usually the case that a checkerboarding position occurs in the opening, when the board is simplified and there aren't too many pieces on the board. It's simply too hard to checkerboard your opponent at move 40 when the game is more complicated. We can now have a look at some real examples of checkerboarding positions. The checkerboarding pheasant or pyramid, shown here, is a good example. The move to e6 removes white's pieces from the e column and from row 3, preventing any moves along those lines. It also creates the classic checkerboarding pattern for white's pieces, as shown. This pattern is repeated through the bunch. Okay, the stones assigned to the red, yellow, and blue boxes are portions of this pattern. Notice that it's not necessary for the pattern to be complete for the checkerboarding position to work. In fact, we would need extra pieces for white here, 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 and here to complete the checkerboarding position. And unfortunately, that's not always practical. But notice that those pieces we would need to complete the position are also white's only legal moves. So we can look at these moves and see from what we've learnt in previous videos that they all are quite uncomfortable looking moves. The b2x square, and three loud moves on the edge or around the bunch. A very uncomfortable f6 move, and an almost equally uncomfortable b4 move. And finally the correct, but not so intuitive move to f2. In tournament games, if you can find a checkerboarding position that your opponent is unfamiliar with, then it's likely to force them to take up a considerable amount of time to determine the best move. In the next example, an internet game between myself and Amy Fu of Australia, played in 2005, it's possibly the most interesting checkerboard position that I've come across. The position actually results in white having to pass at move 22, something that unless heading for a wipeout is almost unheard of. It's also the only complete checkerboarding position that I'm aware of to date. This is the opening sequence. Now, it's quite an unusual opening, and I regret that I was the one being checkerboarded. Black spots the potential of move 13 to f4 to checkerboard my position as white. I now have three moves, and it doesn't matter which order I play them in, black will reply the same each time. If I throw my pieces to the edge here or here, then black replies like this in both cases. And if I play e6, white will reply with e7, keeping up the checkerboarding and forcing me to play another similar move to the edge. I'm now completely out of moves and I have to pass. Now, assume Amy didn't understand checkerboarding as well as she demonstrated in this example, and thought she should not disturb that wall of four white pieces to the south. She would be leaving me with lots of opportunities to cut through the centre of the bunch. You should be able to see that checkerboarding is a powerful tool, but one that can be dangerous if misunderstood. If played badly, it can encourage an overly maximising style of play and lead to a difficult position towards the endgame. We will need to spend some more time looking at what to do if you find yourself checkerboarding, but for the time being, an understanding of such patterns will suffice. Thanks for watching.